adaptation and resilience. The way the CNU Open Innovation Track worked is anybody can present or can, you know, propose absolutely anything they want. They have to propose the format. They have to propose a couple of things. So a number of people proposed the sessions that are here today, and then Eliza helped, and we kind of wrangled them into shape and gave them all the title Adaptation and Resilience. So all of these today will be Pecha Kucha style. Now, formal Pecha Kucha, rigid Pecha Kucha, is 20 slides and 20 seconds each on auto advance. We're going to go ahead and not do that today for various reasons, but everybody is still expected to come in about 6.5, 7 minutes. The idea is it forces you to be concise, and if it's really boring, you only have to put up with it for 6.5, 7 minutes. But nobody's going to be boring here today. So adaptation and resilience. This almost works, except all of my notes are gone. So sorry, this is going to be a little off the cuff. Essentially, I came to CNU as seeing it as the intersection of everything else I cared about in the world, the human settlement pattern. And I see CNU not as being something concerned with buildings or with roads or with any of these things. I see CNU as being the brain trust trying to save civilization. Because we're in a pretty bad backslide right now in as far as civilization goes. I'm not going to get into that too much because we've got limited time and we're already running late. So very briefly, this is kind of the concept. The charter lays out the principles. You've got the economy, you've got the ecology, and you've got society. If you put those together, they form, I have a pointer, the three pieces of the environment. So, you've got economy, society, ecology. Those at the base form the environment. And then here, we don't do things at any one level. Andres talks a lot about subsidiarity, that things should happen, the decisions for things should be made close to the level at which they actually occur. This is kind of a quick jot of those levels. We've got the individual, family, community, neighborhood, city, town, region, state, country, world. So those levels interact with each of these things simultaneously at different places. So the idea is everything has a cost and everything has a benefit, whether it's an action, whether it's a structure, to all three of these directions. So ultimately, all of these interactions make up civilization. So that's kind of the preface to all of the presentations going on today. We're going to be talking about economy, ecology, and society amongst everybody. So the first group of presentations is myself and Scott Douglas, from there to here and back again, and Scott's going to kick it off. You have to auto-advance the slides.
Okay. I have to advance the slides?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm Scott Douglas. I'm a junior designer at DPZ. We're all very aware of how significant history is to design, and I think it's important to also notice that history in a local level can really teach you a lot about relocalization of food production, of craft, and of resource extraction in a new relocalized world that we're rapidly approaching. So this is from my town in Rehoboth, Massachusetts. Was historically a strawberry producing area, and you wouldn't know it now. They're not grown anywhere in the town. But you, if you look into the history of the town, you can learn that there was a crop rotation and very specific commune of the way that farms worked, that the manure that the dairy farms would produce on the fields for most of the year would then enable the nutrient load to produce the strawberries for one crop in the summer. And these things were all very interconnected and on a large scale. And we can learn from the agricultural groups that came out of this, and they got together, pooled their money, and bought wholesale equipment and reached larger markets. And these are sort of things that you can only learn if you look into the local history that you wouldn't generally get from the region. Another town in the area is Fall River, Massachusetts, which was a major textile manufacturer prior to the Civil War. And there is a lot of embodied knowledge and actual leftover bits from this industrial time that you can't really get it from any book, but in garage sales or the backs of old buildings, you can find actually equipment, looms, talk to people that used to work in these factories and actually get knowledge that can help you to foster perhaps something related to that that would give you an opportunity to make it work in a way that you wouldn't have in another place. And also, as Jim is fond of saying, the towns are built that we live in all the most important places, and of course, water power. This infrastructure is all still in place in many of these cities. In some cases, the turbines just have to be reinstalled and things turn back on. But the falls of Fall River, where it got its name, are actually, this is the only part that's exposed. The rest of it was put under an expressway that went through the center of the town. But there's still a lot of infrastructure. Moving on to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And it was always historically a steel area, and we know that, and there's very little of that now. But in the same way that you can get knowledge and materials, I go to Western Pennsylvania for a festival in the summer, and every time that I'm there, there's always someone with a box of hammerheads and of tongs and fantastic 19th century tools that they've just found at garage sales and antique stores. They'll buy the whole lot for $5. And these are things you cannot buy anymore, made of real wrought iron, made of very long-lasting materials. And again, everyone had a blacksmith somewhere in their past in their family, somewhere in Pennsylvania. So there's an embodied knowledge to the place that can help you advance that. Now, this is from a reenactment event. This is not the event that I'm going to talk about, but at Pensac War, which is a Society for Creative Anachronism event, and these people try to reenact basically craft and lifestyle prior to around the 16th century in Europe. And they have brought back into production a lot of processes. Like this is actually smelting iron with a bloomery. And these people came to this event in Western Pennsylvania. They picked taconite out of the farm fields, which is an iron ore. They brought only bricks and hammers, and they put together a kiln, and they actually worked and smelted iron for several days, and then produced at the end of a week spoons and cutlery that they were able to just from the ground itself. So with the application of tools, local knowledge, and raw materials, you are really able. And this is actually what bloom iron looks like when you take it out of the kiln. And this is real wrought iron that prior to the 19th century, this was how a wrought iron was made, and it has glassy inclusions throughout it. That's why real wrought iron railings on older buildings don't corrode after 200 years. It's because of this very specific way of producing it. At the same event, this is a group of people called Sunbaked Studio, and they come with a potter's wheel and screens. And they're actually, they dig clay out of the soil right on site, and they assemble a kiln right from the earth itself and create and fire pottery with no electricity and just bringing two pieces of equipment with them. So I think this, to tie this to kind of together a little bit, resiliency has, we don't have to reinvent the wheel on a local level when we're trying to reestablish these local economies. They existed 50, 60, 100 years ago in these places. And if we look into what was done, it makes it easier to create a resilient new local economy in the same place. And I'm going to end on this diagram because it ties a little bit more into, these are the 12 raw materials necessary to maintain an electrified society. And they're arranged from the white down to the darker gray, from the Stone Age, Bronze Age, Iron Age, and to the 19th century levels of use. But with everything in this diagram, you can actually produce a dynamo, ferrite magnets, copper wires, and these are actually common throughout most of the United States. So thank you very much.
All right, so picking up where Scott left, the presentation was from there to here and back again. So he's brought us from there to here a little bit, and I'm gonna take us back around. That's not on there. All right, so this should say, so support system complexity, and this is time, and this is the multiplication of labor power. So essentially we start here, we start with manpower. You eat 2,000 to 4,000 calories a day. You go out and you cut some fields. You do some work. That is the base increment is manpower. Then you multiply that with beasts of burden. You have animal power, horse power, donkey power, and then we have water power. We have wind power. We start multiplying this. At some point, over here you've got the spike, and that spike is the Industrial Revolution. We start using major amounts of fossil fuels. And it just takes off. So
you know, this is the support system complexity goes up with that. Every single thing that rules the way we are, we live our lives and supports the way we live our lives is based on this multiplication of labor power. One tank full of gas in your car, and I know everybody's got different tanks, so call it 12 gallons, is equivalent to 4 years of human manual labor. So we are at the edge of a precipice, basically. It's about energy productivity, not about energy efficiency. There's something called, Jim mentioned it just earlier.
Jevons paradox,
which basically says that the more efficiently you use a resource, the more that resource will be used. Because more people will use it to do more things, so you're actually not achieving anything. I see energy as the fuel of consumption of everything else. You have more energy, you have more ability to consume all other things. So here we go. I kind of jumped ahead there. So in addition to this, we have the American Municipal Default. A lot of people here are going to be a little bit more aware of this than most people that I talk to, but you have Jefferson County in Alabama, which is completely bankrupt. They can't provide basic services. Braddock, Pennsylvania.
Most of California.
Braddock, Pennsylvania, which Atul in the back is doing some really cool things with, so if you're interested, you should talk to Atul. Braddock, Pennsylvania, their street signs are basically marker on cardboard. The hard time that the entire country has been having is nothing to them. They've been there for a lot longer. But this place, this is where 25% of, I think, the steel in America is produced. But yet, you know, they mechanized. They went from a labor force of 7,000 producing that steel to 600. So that's interesting. Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, they have so many Chuck talks all the time about you have all of these. In addition to building expensive over-engineered infrastructure, that expensive over-engineered infrastructure is setting up an obligation for the next 30, 60, 90 years that no municipality can meet. Harrisburg, Pennsylvania is so bad, they went into receivership, and then the receiver came in and got a better idea of what it looked like, tried to talk some sense into the community regarding what they were going to do, and it went so badly that he pulled a John Galt. He has gone off the face of the earth. He left a note and disappeared in the night. The cities, the municipalities are currently the economies that that run our lives, but they are going to fall. They are done. They're crashing just the same way that everything else is crashing right now. So this is from Jane Jacobs' Economy of Cities, where she talks about an incredible number of things. If you haven't read the book, read it. It is the single most undervalued book regarding anything that we do here that I've come across yet. It's fantastic. So she talks about the spectrum from efficiency to innovation in an economy. As you get more efficient, you lose the ability to innovate. And most businesses, you know, you have a business. You have a new product, you start a business, you grow, you're successful. As you do, you develop more processes. So efficiency is tied to processes. You develop more processes, you kind of, evolve in that direction, and at some point the business is unable to grow what it's doing, it has to go out and buy new businesses. You see this with tech startups all of the time. So innovation is the other direction. If you talk about a city, the economy of a city, it's the same direction. As you get more efficient, you lose the ability to innovate. It's a naturally occurring paradox if you start looking at it. So in our move to efficiency across the entire country, we have stifled any new businesses. And the new things that have come up have been tech companies. The last thing we need is another tech company or another design collective. We need agricultural startups. We need manufacturing startups. And we've got an entire generation of people who had really expensive educations who can't get a job because there are no jobs, because we've killed most of the things providing goods and services, which is actually what money is. Money is nothing if there's no goods and services to back it up. So this is co-working. So I gave you all the doom and gloom. Now I'm moving into here's some of the stuff that we can do about it. This is co-working. This is shared office space. But in addition to shared office space, you've got a wood shop. You've got a metal shop. You've got a jewelry studio. So this is sharing resources to incubate new businesses. But this also doubles in that you can drop it into a blighted neighborhood and give everybody in that neighborhood, you know, the ability to come into this jewelry studio and learn how to do it, to come into this wood shop and learn how to do it, and then the space to start a business, start producing something. This is how you kickstart a neighborhood. This is actually what I'm doing in Miami. I'm starting one of these in a neighborhood across the river from downtown and kickstarting that neighborhood. So co-working, huge deal. Robert's going to talk a little bit about that, mostly about some other stuff. Robert's doing it in New Haven, and it's awesome. So this is the Global Village Construction Set. This is open source blueprints for civilization. So basically it provides a platform and blueprints to do it yourself, make all 50 tools required for civilization, whether this is rural, whether this is, you know, urban paving, whatever it is. So this is really cool. The transition handbook, from oil dependency to local resilience. This started in England. It has taken off. You know, you go to a town meeting, you have a lecture, maybe 50 people, maybe 100 people show up. They start talking about this in these smaller distressed communities. The entire community comes out and basically says, okay, we're broken. You know, all of these regulations that we're required to live by are making it impossible to live, and they're going to fail anyways because they can't support themselves. We're going to just wipe those out. We're going to go to basically effective regional secession, and we're going to start doing things the way they need to be done, and we're going to start making our decisions at our level. A lot of times they even stop paying taxes up the line. In Doral, Florida, you have a whole bunch of farmers out on the edge of sprawl who are so frustrated with all of their tax money being taken, and not only taken and not given back to them in services that they need, but actively used to build sprawl, encroaching on their stuff, that they have stopped paying taxes. They stopped using services, not that they really did anyway. So I think that's a model that's going to be happening a lot more. And I think it's a good thing. And I think that if you can effectively, go ahead and effectively organize in order to stop paying those taxes, bring in a forensic accountant maybe, find out what services are being provided at in a bad way to you or aren't being provided though you're paying for them, withhold that, put some in a legal defense fund, put some in escrow because, you know, they're going to come looking for it at some point, and then put the rest to work. Put your people to work and put the tax money to work the way that you need it. So Build a Better Block. Who here knows about Build a Better Block? Okay, so I won't get into it too much. Essentially, this is a live charrette. It started in Fort Worth. They had a three-lane car sewer that was once the high street, or the main street, and it had been completely destroyed. Everything was dead along it. So the community organized and got a temporary street fair permit for a weekend. But instead of closing the street, they parked cars along it. They repainted the lines. They painted crosswalks. They dropped in potted trees. They had pop-up businesses come in, and they ran it that way for the weekend, still allowing cars to go through. And it was so successful and so loved that the city implemented it. So this is starting to happen all over the country. If you can't get the permits, if you can't go through the planning process, and this is the cheap way to do it. All of these things that I'm showing you, this is saying you're not going to have the money and resources to go through the normal way of doing things that everybody has learned how to do. So how else can you go ahead and basically use almost no money and do the things that you're going to have to do in order to survive? Vocational jobs. I mentioned this a little bit earlier. We need agricultural startups and things like that. This is Mike Rowe. He does the show Dirty Jobs. This is him testifying to Congress regarding the change that he's seen in the 9 years that he's been doing the show, which is just horrifying. I won't get into that too much, but you should check out the testimony. This is an Atlantic Cities article about some of the people that still manage to work in manufacturing and how they're losing their jobs, and how they're required to have multiple college degrees in order to operate a machine where, you know, replacing what might have been 200 jobs that somebody could just get a vocational education out of high school doing. All right, Prophet and the Oracle. That would be Duncan and Jim. So, you're up.
Me?
Yeah, you're up, and then followed by Duncan. So you're just going to advance right here and try to keep it about 20 seconds total or 60.
Where's my thing?
Yep, it's up here, unfortunately.
Okay, good.
Just the photo is out of it.
All right.
So.
Do you want to block him?
No. I'm just going to review some of the macro ideas that I've been retailing for a few years. But I do want to say that I think Karja just really outlined the task really very well. But what I want to talk about are the impediments that are now preventing us from doing the intelligent things. Right now, there's sort of a horse race going on between the destruction of capital, the inability of capital to form in the way that we're used to getting it, and the energy resources that we depend on to run our society. And the race is to see which one's going to put us out of business first. There's a relationship between both of them, and they both have the capacity to shipwreck industrial society, but it's unclear which one's going to win the race so far. And the bottom line is we're going to have to make other arrangements for daily life. We're not willing to do it. Right now, the entire spiritual energy of the nation is being devoted to a campaign to sustain the unsustainable, which is going to be a very unfortunate and tragic thing. A big part of this is the idea and the wish that we can run Walmart, Walt Disney World, suburbia, the military, and the interstate highway by other means than the way that we've been doing it. In other words, we're going to run all that stuff by alternative energy. And the key to understanding our predicament is simply this. We're going to be disappointed by what these things can do for us. We're not going to run them on all those things. We got to make other arrangements instead. We don't want to do it. One of the main reasons we don't want to do it is because of this overwhelming meme that has overtaken American life. The idea, which has become normal for all adults in America, that when you wish upon a star, your dreams come true. This used to be an appropriate idea for seven-year-olds in America, but now it's true for everybody. And the companion idea that is now overtaken America is the idea that it's possible to get something for nothing, which is manifested most clearly in the way that we have taken this activity called gambling and taken it from the margins of society where it was understood to be a marginal behavior because it's not okay for people to think that you can get something for nothing. And we've brought it to the center of American life, including the center of our ability to raise revenue to do the things that we need to do to keep our society going. And when you combine these two ideas that when you wish upon a star, you'll get something for nothing, you end up with a very psychologically unhealthy culture. And that's one of the reasons why we can't figure out what to do. There is also a direct correlation between the distress that a society comes under and the delusional thinking that it begins to exhibit. And as the stress rises, the delusional thinking rises, so that now one of the principal delusions is that some mythical they are going to come out of the woodwork and come up with something that will allow us to keep on running all of those things by magical means. I refer to this as techno-narcissism. And so we have to get serious about what the real intelligent response to all this is. It's very simple. We're going to have to downscale all of the major systems that we depend on for everyday life, and we're going to have to relocalize them. We're not prepared to do that because of the investments that we've already made. We're going to have to do farming differently, do it closer to home. It's probably going to have to be done at a smaller scale with fewer machines, at least with fewer fossil fuel-powered machines. And we're not even thinking about it. We're going to have to reorganize commerce and rebuild local networks of economic interdependence, which in one form that can be understood is retail on Main Street. That's one form of that. We're going to have to do schooling differently. We're not prepared to do that because so much of we've gold-plated the investments we've made in the centralized gigantic schools, and we're not prepared to let go of that. We're going to have to make some things in America in the future. We will probably have a lot to do with water power and hydroelectric, but we're not prepared to think about that. And we're going to have to inhabit the landscape differently. We're not prepared to think about that either. Instead, where we are left in the position of being a nation of overfed clowns. And this actually reflects on the gender wars of the last several decades. Because what we're going to have to, a big part of the remedy of this is that we have to man up. It's very important to man up now. And this is not okay. I want to explain this to you so that you understand what you're seeing. 4-year-olds have very large torsos and short legs. And so when you see men dressed in this costume, what they're saying is, I am still a baby. I did not manage to develop successfully. And I'm going to portray myself as a baby. And then I will accessorize it with a hat that I don't understand how it functions, so I'm going to wear it backwards or sideways, and then I'm going to wear shoes that I don't lace up because I don't know how to tie my shoes yet, in spite of the fact that I'm 21 years old. So this is not okay. Men have to grow. And by the way, there's absolutely no analog for this in females. Young females, if anything, dress like hypersexualized adults, but the men dress like babies. And this should tell us something about where we're at in society right now. Okay, I'm going to discuss a lot of these issues in the book that I just finished writing. It's coming out in a month, and it's called Too Much Magic from the Atlantic Monthly Press. And there you go. That's all I got to say today.
Okay. All right, what do I do? All right. Hey, everyone. I'm Duncan Crary, and some of you might know me. I'm the host and the producer of a weekly podcast with James Howard Kunstler called the KunstlerCast. And Karja asked me to talk a little bit about how I've been helping to get the word out about these issues to maybe a new audience in a new way, and how it's affected my own life and decisions that I make. I did take the podcast and I turned it into a book, so it's kind of a strange new media project going back into old media, but it's called the KunstlerCast. That's an oversized clown over there, or land whale. He's riding his rascal scooter across the parking lot. I don't know, like a lot of people, I first became aware of these issues of the problems of the built environment by reading The Geography of Nowhere in the mid-90s. I'm sort of still living in the mid-90s, by the way. We'll get to that in a minute. But and that's what brought me into this fold eventually. And I was a regular print journalist for a little while after college, and I used to interview Jim for the newspaper, and I interviewed a lot of people. And I always regretted when I was writing a magazine article or a newspaper article that I could only put a little soundbite of what the person said. The people I talked to were so smart, I wanted to just let them talk for a long time. And when I finally asked Jim if he wanted to do a podcast, that's what we've been doing for 4 years. I've just been letting Jim roll. I'm kind of an activist. I call myself a slacktivist, but I'm acutely aware of this thing. This is one of my favorite blogs, Stuff White People Like. And one of the things that white people like is raising awareness. And it's like, all you got to do is raise awareness for the problem, and then you just can, you know, pat your hands and walk off. You did, mission accomplished. And I'm sensitive to it because I am a slacktivist as a journalist and other things. But I have been doing some things. I think the only thing I've ever done is really heroic is I made the decision 10 years ago to just commit to living in the city of Troy, New York, working in the city of Troy, New York, and playing in the city of Troy, New York. And I'll tell you why that's kind of heroic in a minute. But this was my little Troy, New York meme. It's, you guys don't know where it is. You probably think, you think it's New York City. If you're from New York City, you think I live with Cletus the slack-jawed yokel. My friends all think I live in the Island of Misfit Toys. Suburbanites think I live in a third world ghetto. I think I live in Brigadoon. And where I really live is that last slide, and I'm going to show you a bigger version of that. This is my neighbor. That's my apartment in there. Look at that place. People call this the Troilet. It's like one of the most beautiful urban fabrics I've ever seen. It's only got 50,000 people. It's right on the Hudson River. We got a real cast of characters. And I've been listening to Jim, and I've been talking with Jim for years, and I've been hearing about these issues, and I've been kind of using Troy, New York as like a petri dish, you know, for what he's been talking about how we're going to have to man up and, I don't know, become innovative in how we live our lives. And I am also a publicist, so I pull stunts. So let me walk you through this quickly. I used to have an office in downtown Albany about 9 miles away, and that's my ex-girlfriend, and you'll find out why she's my ex in a minute. I used to make her canoe to work with me. I called it canooting. I mean, there was really no purpose to it other than the fact that I lived on a city on a river, and I worked in another city on the same river, and most people just drive their cars between them, and I figured I would just see if I could paddle it. And we didn't usually dress up that nicely, but that was for a magazine article. There's a book that came out called The Very Hungry City by Austin Troy that has a chapter about my canoeing kookiness. But I took that idea, which had no real purpose, and I decided to do something profitable. I started my own consulting business, and I approached the owner of a local cruise boat, And I said, why don't we start do an experiment? We're going to actually take people to and from these two cities by riverboat, the way that, you know, when my father was a kid, you could hop on a boat in Albany, New York, and you could go anywhere all the way down to New York City, anytime pretty much you wanted to. And we did it, and it was fun, and we made money, and I'd like to do it again sometime. But that's how I started to take these kooky ideas and my skills as a publicist and a publicity hog and try to actually do something that might be viable in the future. We could take 125 cars off the road doing this. We didn't, but we could have. Okay. I am about to embark on another journey. There are very few commercial vessels on the Erie Canal, which begins in Troy, New York, and it goes all the way to Lake Erie in Buffalo. But there's one... a group of guys. They graduated from RPI as architects. They became disillusioned. They read The Long Emergency. They heard about the energy scarcity issues. They bought a fleet of tugboats. And they set up shop in Troy, and they run freight between Oswego and Troy, mostly. And I'm actually going to be riding on the Margo as soon as I leave this conference, telling this sort of heroic story of bringing the Erie Canal back to life. Because as we've said, all of the cities in this country are where they are because they occupy important places. And where I live, it's on the water, you know, from Troy to Schenectady to Amsterdam to Utica to Rome to Syracuse to Buffalo. That's why these places are where they are. And I'm going to be telling the story of these guys. And they did tell me that now that diesel is pushing $4 a gallon, they can now compete for not just oversized goods, but bulk, meaning they can throw a bunch of, you know, wheat and grain on a barge and haul 3,000 tons from Oswego to Troy and actually beat the tractor trailers and the trains even. So tune in, canalers.com. Thank you very much.
Okay, I have, compared to the last presentations, a boring presentation, I'm afraid to say. I'm actually looking at a something that could happen. Well, not that the thing that have been shown could, they are happening, but this is something that's sort of been, it's a new urbanist speak, and it's... but it's something is a sleeping giant that I'd like to bring attention to that might get us somewhere. And I'm calling it jobs-oriented development. If we look, this is a typical slide we see in a lot of lectures. This is Hartford, Connecticut in the 1950s and current Hartford today. But this could be any city in America. This, you know, is a thriving metropolis, feels very pedestrian, no highways. Now we have highways and most of it's torn down. What I want you to notice is what's left is jobs. A lot of office buildings, a lot of institutions. Hartford is sort of the insurance capital still of the world. And by the way, the Martin guitar is, from your slides, is the largest guitar manufacturer still, and they still make most of it by hand, and is doing very well. I can't remember where they're located.
Nazareth, Pennsylvania,
right. In a dumpy town, but they are really hopping. But anyway, we trash places like this. There's no life after dark. It's ugly. In fact, that's what I forgot my segue. Where did all this stuff go? There. and so people are choosing to get on this in order to hey, I like this not Petra Kucha style. I can go back and forth. to do that. And meanwhile, this is what it looks like when you get outside of the office towers. You got the vacants and the low rises, right? And it's really not a very delightful place or a place that you would be attracted to living, and that's why people live in these suburban communities, and there's a lot of other reasons too I won't go into, but anyway, that's what we're left with. That's the real fabric, and so it's created a new kind of human lifestyle that's divided between the stoop kids and the corner kids. Stoop kids are kids that are told by their parents, their mothers usually, because the fathers are long gone, that they can't leave the stoop. They got to sit on the stoop, and they sit there all day. And the corner kids are also told they got to sit on the stoop, but they go to the corner, where of course they get involved in the drug traffic scene. The future of the stoop kids is up here, and the future of the corner kids is down here. Some of you may recognize these pictures taken from an HBO TV show. But anyway, I've learned a lot watching the show The Wire. This is Omar. But what has been discovered in this TV show is it's all a kind of behavioral pattern based on environment. And if you alter the environment, and this is a case where they actually took the corner kids out from the rest of the classroom, and they divided the classroom up between stoop kids and corner kids, and they stopped trying to teach the corner kids. It turned out that they were all incredibly brilliant, because that's why they became corner kids, because you have to be really smart to survive on the corner. That they began to get more human behavior, and also through better policing, they began to sort of, there was a possibility that something could be done. And the result is, here's that Omar guy in a possible neighborhood, a cartoon. Omar coming, yeah, yo, you know. That means everybody get out of here. But anyway, so there are two possibilities that we're presented with on how to repair the situation. One that are all being debated currently in the within the new urbanist circles and so on. One is this kind of let's take the open spaces and landscape it and turn it into these primordial situations. And the other is looking at the coding and the built form. This happens to be a project that we're working on in Stony Creek, Connecticut, where all we did is we took the existing zoning, which basically made 97% of all the properties in this community were non-conforming, which meant that if you did anything to your house, you had to get a variance. Like if you wanted to add a bay window or even change a window. If you replace a window, you could do that. But if you want a new window, you had to go before the zoning board and get permission for it. So we sort of went through, this was Dan Bartman and Carol Wilbur and I last weekend, and we figured out what we sort of rewrote the coding to sort of reflect what's there. And this is what we ended up with. This chart replaced that chart. Most of this was pretty useless. And what a lot of us are key to doing is to look at this 1929 Clarence Perry, the neighborhood, and to create the neighborhood center, the neighborhood edge, the walkable circle, et cetera, et cetera. And this example of the build-outs in Montgomery, the conventional build out under zoning, which as I showed in that Stony Creek example, basically you're not allowed to do anything, versus the white knights coming in, the new urbanists being able to build out, and actually there's a whole sequence of pictures that shows the creation of neighborhood centers, et cetera, et cetera. And if this is a map of Dorchester, just outside of Boston. And what's interesting to me, it's a use map. So that the yellow is residential, the purple is, I think, industrial, or blue is institutional, red is commercial. And so I've actually been using this slide in my teaching for a long time, because if you draw a quarter mile circle around all those red areas, you get, bingo, the walkable ped shed. And you can see how it perfectly shows where the centers of all these neighborhoods are. But it occurred to me that, you know, we don't have this healthy kind of urbanism like the Hartford example. So I looked at, okay, what would happen if we draw circles around the purple areas and the blue areas? And here's the blue areas, and you see that, and I think I got overzealous in this. I'd like to go back and get rid of the teeny little blue ones so it would make more sense. You know, it pretty much follows the corridors. And then this is the purple. This is if you draw the circles around the industrial zones. And when you put it all together, you see that the industrial, if you call it the industrial walk sheds, the institutional walk sheds, and the pedestrian and the neighborhood, the Perry walk sheds. And if you look at the Perry map, there are no jobs, right? It's just shops, civic, you know, there's a civic center, and then there's housing, and then there's sort of little shops at the corners, and that's it. And then there's an arrow that says business. But business is part of our lives, and business exists in our cities currently. Some of the largest job centers are in our inner cities. And this is not even sure what that is. I think that's an extra slide. So this is Evansville, Indiana, the town I grew up in. We were working on a project here, and it occurred to me, this is you know, that kind of Baltimore type neighborhood, a lot of murders, a lot of drug trafficking. But we have a huge regional hospital up here. We have another hospital down here. We have a huge plastic manufacturing plant over here. And when you sort of put those on the jobs, there's 12,900 people that work in this place. There's 8,700 that work over here, 5,200, 7,500. There's 34,000 people working in this area and getting on that highway to go home. I mean, if you told a developer, okay, I'm going to put 12,000 people on this point right here, what can you do with it? I bet they'd come up with answers. So if you, let's say that 80% of those people want to live in the suburbs, but we could capture 20% of them, that's 6,800 people. And if we just take a little urban lot, 50 by 100 foot lot, 5,000 feet, that's 787 acres, which is an area that's got about a mile on each side. This is that same neighborhood. And you could fit 7 seasides in that area. This is my last slide. So if you were to, you don't want to think of these as neighborhood centers, but they're neighborhood creators. And if you put your neighborhoods, like in that Dorchester example, and redo the coding so that it actually reflects what's there, and it actually allows for better, all the kinds of things that neighborhoods know how to do, you can rebuild a city just based on the fact that there are so many people already living there. That's it.
All right, Steve, do you want to go ahead and introduce your kind of composition while I queue up your presentation?
So I'm myself, Seth Harry, and Mike Mahaffey, if we manage to get him online, are going to do a presentation on our view, our perspective on adaptation and resilience. My perspective is going to be, having done climate action plans in primarily in California, which includes adaptation. Yeah, that's it. And Seth will talk about the
commerce portion of it, and I'm not sure what Mike's going to do, but I'm sure, as usual, it'll be entertaining. I wanted to also mention that I was forced to man up when I, at 18, I went to Paris Island and joined the Marine Corps, and unfortunately wound up killing a lot of people, and so I would propose that what I would like to see is people become functional human beings. I mean, that's what we at least need in my city of Oakland. So I'm going to talk about resilience. Oh, so it doesn't come up here?
No.
Oh, that's okay. Okay, so as I mentioned, this is the offshoot of climate action plans we've done, and primarily around climate change and global warming and its impact on regions and its impact nationally, state, regionally, and internationally, decrease precipitation and so on. You can read that. And particularly in the West, it's we really have some severe drought conditions that we'll be facing. But in other parts, it's more flooding and inundation. So climate, global warming will impact different areas, of course, in different ways. In the West, particularly, the decline of the snowpack is really a significant problem. We're faced with some severe consequences downstream of that, particularly in agriculture. And I did a little study in Alameda, which is a little island in the East Bay, in the San Francisco East Bay, and just looking at some of the impacts of sea level rise. And you see 1 meter, 2 meters. So pretty much this little island, which is highly populated, becomes just a little little blob on the screen. And of course, this is just the San Francisco Bay, and we're looking at these impacts worldwide. I mentioned agriculture, the impact on livestock and production, food production, and even though agriculture may be in some ways more resilient or at least adaptable, the increased heat, pest, water stress, and so on will impact our ability to feed ourselves, I predict. And this is just one look at what might be in store for parts of our country. Public health impacts we are looking at more carefully, threats to human health, and just the heat stress. I'm working in Gilroy, and the consequences of long-term high temperatures is really significant on people, asthma and other kinds of health impacts. Social environmental will have a significant impact. Pollution, economic, all of these are consequences that we will be forced to face, and including not just in the U.S., but in some areas. Seth's been working in Guatemala, and I've been in Mongolia, and we're looking at how do we justify the middle class lifestyle that we're enjoying here when other areas will be suffering perhaps unequally. So adaptation, the definition that working definition that we use is the efforts to accommodate or overcome the impacts of, in this case, primarily global warming, but also the economic, social economic impacts that we're facing as fossil fuels decline and we're forced to look at other sources of energy. So, the reason I look like this probably is I just got back from Mongolia, where I'm advising the city on how to deal with the fact that you have tremendous numbers of people over the last 7 or 8 years, herders moving out of these rural areas and moving into the city and literally just consuming vast amounts of land area with very low density, with little yurts and then little buildings. No sewer, no water, no power in many of these. It's already a disaster in the making, so the city's looking at how to accommodate this. This is a result. I mean, part of what's driving this is the severity of the winters. Global warming may be a long-term trend, but the climate impacts can be regional. Severity of the winters, which are causing great die-offs in some of the herds, but also the economic. This is an area of economic boom because of the mining, so you're actually pulling people in for economic reasons that have nothing to do with climate change, but have to do with the fossil, with the fact that they need those resources for energy and other reasons. Resilience, the capacity and potential and I'm saying at the, this is my definition, neighborhood, community, and regional scale to respond successfully and overcome these in these adverse impacts. And this is just a little drawing that sort of the emotional response to resilience, you know, where you actually do things locally, you feed yourself, you have a robust civic life. Everything that the other speakers have described, it's, in some ways, is embodied in this little sketch here. However, we're also facing other other forces, such as geoengineering. I mean, there's some very serious proposals in front of us to mitigate, particularly to mitigate climate change. And while geoengineering attempts may be are in the offering, the for proposed interventions, you know, we're not sure of what the consequences of the, those geoengineering efforts are to blow seawater into the air. Assessing the strategies and actions. So how do we assess these the different types of proposals in front of us? How can we advocate for good urbanism as a remedy for mitigation, adaptation, and resilience building? You know, what, so you know, in the face of people who are advocating some of these technological remedies in particular, or the specter of the doomers, and I consider the doomers, you know, the survivalists, people who are saying it's all going to hell, and, you know, we basically, there's no use doing anything, but it's another response. So to me, good urbanism bridges that gap, that the ground between the sort of technobots and the doomers for the reasons I described here, but I don't have enough time to go into. So I'm just suggesting four different measures that we should look at: time-tested, vernacular, pervasive, and there we go. Okay, and I'll just basically time-tested, what's worked best over the long run? I mean, this is, in a way, for new urbanists, this is sort of what one of our core principles. We use what works in the long term. We have many failed or outright struggled remedies that we don't use anymore. And, you know, the DPC's work in Haiti is one example, I think, of a contemporary version of what's worked in the long run. A vernacular, sustainable solutions can be employed with relative efficiency over for lots of people, not just the specialized people or people who can afford it. And you know, one way to do this is through conservation and reuse, and then use of, you know, good building materials that absorb solar heat instead of, you know, photovoltaics, and capture wind and so on. Pervasive, what remedies offer broad applicability for a wide range of circumstances that can be used, you know, widely? And passive solar is an example of that. Connectivity, I mean, it's a perfect example of something that's pervasive. You make something connected, it impacts lots of people everywhere in a positive way. Pervasive. And then finally, virtuous, and this is the sort of the long-term residual impacts of our interventions. What can we do that has positive long-term consequences? And the sort of poster child of the opposite is the sort of ethanol, the use of ethanol for as a fuel. And, you know, virtuous, you're building great places at whatever scale you're doing, and these have positive long-term consequences. So faced with these impacts, life will force us to, it will force itself on us with or without us. So I'm just proposing that good urbanism might represent our default approach, and I suggest we evaluate using these metrics. Good urbanism meets all four of those conditions, enabling us to build on that middle ground between the extremes I showed you. And I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Seth Carey? All right, go ahead and introduce yourself while I get it queued up.
Continuing the Back to the Future thread, I talk a lot about retail and wanted to sort of try to understand how we got ourselves in this condition in the first place, and so that we might understand how to get back out of it, and whether or not, in fact, urbanism plays a significant role in that.
Okay.
Thank you.
This is really an adaptation of a topic I've been talking about for a while. But anyway, sustainable commerce is really an idea that embodies these notions. It's locational efficiency, it's balanced and equitable, it's flexible and robust, and it's comprehensive by nature. One of the issues And when we talk about resiliency, the definition of resiliency, I guess, is the ability to adapt to changes in our circumstances. The question is, do we actually have the capacity to do that? And this is a model, sort of a transect, including the fourth dimension of time, and this notion that cities evolve in levels of complexity, but certain prototypical or retail types remain. And so this is the sort of the country store that migrates across the transect to become the corner store. Much smaller trade area, but it's basically the same prototypical type of store, and at the same time, you're getting additional layers of complexity. And when you start to really analyze how traditional urban centers function, you start to see the same recurring patterns over and over again, which, for instance, Robert was talking about in his slide. The idea is that this supports a very diverse regional economy, and one time we sat around and just kind of tried to think about all of the things that used to be produced almost exclusively locally. We're really surprised how many things that we sort of take for granted, like, for instance, energy and transportation that all used to be produced locally. And, of course, that was talked about in a great deal in the introduction. So in kind of comparing suburban retail to traditional urban retail and the larger economic framework that it supports, suburban retail is really dictated by the size. You know, the size of the box is essentially directly related to the size of the road in front of it, whereas urban retail actually reflects the context in which it's located. The problem is, in the post-war era, when the highway became the dominant form of accessing daily goods and services, it supported and encouraged when you're really essentially creating a generic environment that provided generic goods and services to a generic consumer, it sort of encouraged this kind of what I'm calling a horizontally disintegrated global distribution system. The problem with that is that this perceptual framework, you're only able to see or perceive a portion of this at any given point in time from a spatial point of view. So for instance, where things are produced in China, we don't see the larger environmental impacts of that, the economic impacts of that, the social impacts of that. As the consumer, on the consumer end, you're not aware of those things as well. So the idea was to kind of create a framework that was more vertically integrated and spatially defined, i.e. a regional system where both the consumer and the producer had an awareness of each other and the larger implications of the production and use and disposal of those products. Once I came up with this diagram to sort of illustrate this idea, I realized that there was a problem with this. What we really needed was something that talked about how those different economic sectors should be represented proportionally in a healthy regional economy. And so this is sort of my version of the FDA food triangle, talking about economic development. And the idea is that these are not and should not be all equally sized. Current economic theory focuses on this concept of clusters, where you focus on a single strata and you try to optimize around that in terms of differentiating yourself in the marketplace. But really what we need is this. We need a regional economic value-added pyramid where there's equal, where there's appropriate levels of focus in the economy based on what you need to have a fully functioning, sustainable, healthy regional economy as a whole. And this is really sort of ties in, I think, very well to all of the other presentations that we're giving you. You can start to see how this kind of framework could really begin to rebuild that. And this was designed to go fast, so I'm done.
Awesome. Okay, so you've got about 2.5 minutes while I get everything set up for Michael Mahaffey, because he is not here, but we're going to go ahead and just have him on the phone and run through the slides. So you've got just a couple minutes at most there. Let's see.
I just realized I actually did have two more slides. There are some issues. This is available on our website, but it talks about some of the policy tools that you can use to actually restructure regions on this basis.
I can do that. That's what we've got. We've got Keith Bowers and we've got Joanna. So, all right, we'll go ahead and have Michael last.
Or after Joanna.
Okay, and we've also still got Keith as well. So, Joanna, if you want to
you want to go, let me just get this downloading.
So I'm not going to see it here?
No, unfortunately not.
Wow.
I just wasn't figuring that out.
So I have to push on the button, too?
Yep.
Okay.
This is what happens when I get presentations absolutely last minute, unfortunately.
Okay. Okay. I did this very strictly. I thought we had to be really...
That was the plan, but unfortunately when I got the slides so last minute, I just didn't have the time to...
come on.
All right.
Come on.
Okay.
I thought that was part of the cool game.
Yeah, I wanted it to be, but it just it didn't happen. Okay.
All right. There we go. So. All right. Okay. human settlements are for the long term, adaptable and able to evolve positively over time, resilient, bouncing forward after setbacks. They must be loved and cared by their people. To achieve this settlement, each settlement must have a wonderful local quality all its own. That is what we want to achieve in Bahia Muyuyo in Ecuador, a new settlement on 450 hectares with 2.2 kilometers of sandy beaches, a wonderful climate, and 2 hours from Guayaquil. It's all about taking a holistic approach, designing for people and understanding the context, researching what people want, what they can't find, what they miss from their childhood, what they want for their future. It's about building on assets, repairing what is damaged, and providing for what is lacking. We do this by deciphering the wonderful precedents in the region and researching places and buildings that no longer exist, but that people loved so dearly. Places that celebrated local living. Those are the neighborhoods and buildings to emulate. We also want to learn from other places, designs, but also strategies of development. We want to borrow and then carefully adapt what we borrow to address local needs and dreams. It's not about using generic solutions, for no matter how great they may be, they lead to sterile places. Bahia Muyuyo will be a place of variety and choice, a wide range of places to live, work, and have fun. A country village, a harbor town, walkable neighborhoods, waterfront properties, villas, sport facilities, agricultural fields, workshops, stores, restaurants, and even industrial sites. Don't forget, this is about 1,200 acres along the ocean, so it's big. Muyuyo will offer places for many lifestyles. That's what resilience is all about. All T-zones will exist, each offering new and real local qualities of place. The oceanfront will be left wild for nature to thrive, but also for people to enjoy. The urban areas will be designed based on social and economic patterns. There will be a town plaza and malecon along the new marina. There will be row houses with suportal for protection from the sun and for shops and restaurants to expand into the public realm. There will be rooftop terraces and private pools, and there will be many places to work. Bahia Muyuyo will be one of the only places along the Ecuadorian coast to offer many and various types of waterfront homes with private docks, spacious gardens down to the water. Streets between homes will promote walking and social interaction, though accessible to the car. There will be many acres of countryside with narrow meandering roads, different lot sizes to grow food, for orchards, for vineyards, barns, and meadows. Country homes will have terraces, lojas, roof towers to enjoy the year-round temperate climate. The market village along the main road at the top of the site will cater to the whole area and the region, providing a central square for exchange of services and goods, for industries to flourish, and traditional homes with workshops and stores on the ground floor. There'll be gateway, this will be a gateway village to Bahia Muyuyo. We will develop codes specifically calibrated to assure character. Streets and roads throughout will each have a local beauty and practicality. We will offer wonderful ways to walk and bike, to take public transport, and to travel by car. Resilience means responding locally and diversely to local dangers, such as rising water levels. Some private properties will connect directly to the ocean dunes, and in other places, a road and malecon will border the ocean. Always local in character in all the designs. Resilience has also other meanings. It means addressing the local damages of monoculture agriculture, which this land has really suffered from. Planners and permaculture experts have been collaborating to determine where and how to best settle the land and to develop networks of green belt swales, introducing the Muyuyo plant, which has been lost, which has yellow flowers, and local vegetation. Traditional vernacular patterns will also, again, be the norm, celebrating the climate and local context. Muyuyo will promote courtyards, ventilating roofs and towers, shuttered loggias and windows, and suportal to enjoy living on the equator. Building designs and techniques will respond and once again express the local culture and way of life. We will have architectural guidelines to promote character and harmony and references for typologies and architectural elements. Talented architects will be invited to design buildings that belong. Shutters will once again allow cross-ventilation, provide privacy and security, and best of all, create wonderful light patterns. Living naturally without air conditioning will be a delight. Manufacturing beautiful, ingenious shutters will become a flourishing local business. Local materials and building techniques will be the only way to build. Locally grown wood, particularly bamboo, and local building products will be in demand, promoting industries while providing more resilient places to live. Bahia Muyuyo will be developed phase by phase to allow for adjustments as conditions change, to ensure that each phase is viable on its own without disturbing previous ones, and to establish key ingredients early on so they have time to develop and mature. Bahia Muyuyo will have character all its own. It will come alive because it is based upon natural assets, quality precedents, and dreams. It will promote thriving settlements, ensure safe environments, encourage healthy, prosperous lifestyles, and will be designed for people. Bahia Muyuyo will be resilient and it will be adaptable. It will be loved and cared for generations to come. There we are. That was 7 minutes.
Awesome. All right, Keith. Okay, let's see, where is everything?
So my name is Keith Bowers. I'm landscape architect by training, but I practiced my whole career in restoration ecology and conservation biology, and have been on sort of the edge between new urbanism planning, landscape architecture, and the conservation and restoration of the Earth's resources and species. So what I would like to talk about in my next 7 minutes is biodiversity and how biodiversity needs to play a more critical and important role in the work that we all do. Peter Calthorpe did a great presentation this morning and talked about the ecological footprint of the Earth. Stole some of my thunder here. Basically, as Peter mentioned, I think the United States is consuming 5 times the amount of resources it has in terms of its land availability. China and India, much less, but because of the rise in lifestyles in China and India, that's going to put a bigger burden on the Earth. And in fact, we are already exceeding our carrying capacity in the Earth, as Peter had talked about. In somewhere in the 1980s, scientists have determined that we have reached that sort of one Earth or beyond one Earth carrying capacity. So now we're in a deficit. So my sort of question to all of you, or my statement to all of you, is being sustainable enough? Can we just sustain what we're doing now? Do we really want to be sustaining what we do now? Or do we have to really think about a new level? Do we have to think about being regenerative and starting to regenerate these ecological processes and ecological functions that are in disrepair? Columbus was wrong. The world is flat, as Thomas Friedman has reminded us, and that has had all kinds of consequences and will continue to have major consequences in terms of our natural resources and biodiversity on Earth. Just the movement of, we think about the movement of people around the globe, the movement of species around the globe, it is unprecedented. And we're seeing invasions of non-native species, we're seeing complete destructions of our indigenous or native ecosystems because of this movement around the world. So somehow we have to figure out what we can do about this. In fact, scientists are now coming up, they've coined a new term called novel ecosystems, where we're seeing ecosystems being developed now with an assemblage of plants and animals that have never been put together before on the face of the Earth. And so how do we begin dealing with these novel ecosystems? And then bye-bye birdie, halfway to number six. And what I mean by that is that we're now entering the sixth great extinction on Earth, that we're losing species anywhere from 100 to 1,000 times faster than any of the other 5 extinctions that have occurred on Earth. Reason we have such a widespread of between 100 and 1,000 is because we haven't even begun to identify all the species on Earth yet. Yet we're losing them at a tremendous amount. And in fact, all these species up here, I usually have rolling credits. These are all the species that have either disappeared in my lifetime or are about to disappear in my lifetime. So it's pretty amazing. The biodiversity crisis, the rapid loss of species and the rapid degradation of ecosystems is probably a greater threat than global climate change to the stability and prosperous future of humankind on Earth. That was just published by Science Daily. And E.O. Wilson, the famous entomologist from Harvard, says the one process now going on that will take millions of years to correct is the loss of genetic and species diversity by the destruction of natural habitats. This is the folly our descendants are least likely to forgive us. And he goes on to say, if all mankind were to disappear, the world would regenerate back to the rich state of equilibrium that existed 10,000 years ago. If insects were to vanish, the environment would collapse into chaos. And that's exactly what's happening out there right now. And a really big cause of that is habitat fragmentation. And in fact, you know, what we try to do in terms of new urbanism is correct problems like this, right? That we're completely fragmenting all the habitat out there. And I really believe that new urbanism is a real key to reconnecting that habitat and keeping habitat connected if done right. In fact, new urbanism is all about diversity, it's about density, it's about connectedness, walkability, size, scale, and relationships. And as Andres Duany reminded us yesterday morning, it's also about complexity. It needs to be calibrated. It's flexible, and there's a way to opt out. And if we think about ecological systems, all those characteristics apply. And so why aren't we doing ecological overlays and ecological planning when we're looking at new urbanism as well? In fact, what we've done is we've modeled our concept based on this sort of Venn diagram that for somehow, some way, we can make equal the environment, social, and economic needs of society, which to me is totally ludicrous. Because to me, without environment, we don't have society and we don't have economy. So I'm not sure how we're really going to do that. And we focused really all of our sustainability measures on energy, which is good. We need to do that because we are in a climate crisis here, and we need to find ways to replace our non-renewable energy with renewable energy. But we also need to be looking at biodiversity on Earth and habitat fragmentation and making sure that we're doing everything we can to fix that and not to fool ourselves. In fact, I typically go home to my wife and kids and they say, what did you do today? And I say, well, I rearranged deck chairs on the Titanic. And hopefully, I will stop saying that pretty soon. But really to replace that Venn diagram, I think we have to think about, as Peter reminded us this morning, what is the Earth's carrying capacity? The environment's really the core of that. Then we can overlay social society. Then we can overlay the economy on that. And really, when we talk about the environment, we have to be thinking about all those processes that are sort of invisible to us but play a huge role in how we develop the landscape. That's energy flows, trophic levels, nutrient mineral cycling, hydrologic flows, soil development, biological diversity, and disturbance regimes, which play a big role. And then when we think about the social aspects of this, we have to be thinking about civic engagement and what I call ecological democracy. And again, I think all of these concepts fit very well with new urbanism. And then finally, economy. As it was reminded us by Peter and by Andres Duany, we need to be going back to looking at locally based, locally sourced economy. So we can take this and we can apply it from an ecological standpoint as well. And we can do this in a way that adds the complexity, it adds the diversity, it adds the connectedness back to the landscape for a lot of these species to survive. So my recommendations are that we need to really build off the great new urbanism principles, initiatives, and even form-based codes that are being developed from an ecological standpoint. We need to employ a living systems overlay. We need to think about going beyond sustainability and really thinking about a living systems approach or a regenerative approach. We need to integrate the principles of conservation biology, landscape ecology, and restoration ecology into everything that we do. And we also need to base that on sound science. I've seen so many plans come up with green swaths through them or little parks or this area is going to be reserved for wildlife without any type of scientific underpinning whatsoever. And really that just really causes a sink for species to eventually become extinguished. We need to regenerate ecological processes and levels at all scales, so not only from the scale of the regional level, but also all the way down to the communities and neighborhoods and site level. And last of all, we need to really celebrate biodiversity in everything that we do. Thank you. Mm-hmm.